Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch.
And I'm Lauren Gawne, and today we're getting enthusiastic about writing as a technology. But first, do you wish there was more Lingthusiasm to listen to? Even though this is episode 52, we have almost 100 episodes of Lingthusiasm. Some of them exist as bonus episodes over at our Patreon.
So if you want to listen to those and have more Lingthusiasm in your earballs, you can go to patreon.com/lingthusiasm. And this also helps keep the show ad-free. If you like listening to a show without ads, help us keep doing that.
The Patreon also fosters this wonderful linguistics enthusiastic community. In fact, we have a Discord server, which is basically just a wonderful chat space for people to talk about linguistics. There are over 350 people on the Lingthusiasm Discord right now.
So if you wish you had other Lingthusiasts to talk to share your interesting linguistics anecdotes and memes and general nerdery, and you want more people like that to talk to, you can join the Patreon to also get access to the Discord. We launched the Discord community just a year ago, and it's been really fun to see it grow and thrive and take on a life of its own since then. So if you are already a patron and you haven't linked your Patreon and Discord account together, it's there waiting for you, or feel free to come join us.
We have Patreon supporter levels at a range of tiers. Some of them include additional merch. One of my favorite perks is the very scientific Lingthusiasm IPA quiz, where we send you a short quiz and then we give you your own custom IPA character, which is enshrined on our wall of fame.
It's a fun quiz. We have fun looking at people's answers.
Our most recent bonus episode is a collection of some of our favorite anecdotes from interviews and from other episodes that didn't quite make it in to the original episode, and we're delighted to share those in that bonus episode.
So you get to see a bit behind the scenes with that episode. Also, do you want more linguistics on your favorite other podcasts?
Always.
Constantly. We are also very happy to do podcast interviews on other shows about various topics. So if there are other podcasts that you like that you wish would do a linguistics episode and interview one of us, you should tell them that. We're happy to come on. Tag us both or something on social media, or tell your favorite podcast that they could do a linguistics episode, because we'd be happy to do that.
Gretchen, do you remember learning how to read?
Not really. I mean, I remember encountering like the alphabet chart in my first year of school, but I already sort of knew the alphabet at that point. And I guess there was some point when I didn't know how to read and there was some point when I did, but I don't really have concrete memories of that. Do you remember learning how to read?
I feel like I have more memories of learning how to write, just because it's such a mechanical thing. I remember the sitting there writing out a row of A's. I definitely wrote the number 5 backward for way longer than I probably should have, which is a really common thing that happens when kids are learning to write, because it is a combination of like brain skills and fine motor skills. But reading in English is something I feel like I've always just been able to do. I mean, I guess in comparison, learning to read Nepali, which is written in a different script, it's written in the Devanagari script, I have more memories of that because I did that in my 20s. And even now, I still feel the real disconnect between being relatively able to chat and really struggling to read and write. I still have to put my finger under the words as I'm going through, whereas with English, it just feels like the words are beaming straight into my brain because I learned to read that language so early in my life.
Yeah, like I read at this sort of automatic level. I can't see a sign that says stop on it and not read it in Latin script. But in undergrad, I took both ancient Greek and Arabic. And in Greek, I kind of got to the point, because the script is sort of similar enough and I was familiar enough with the letters previously-ish, that I kind of got to the point where I could sort of very slowly sound out words as I was reading them out loud, because we had to do a lot of reading aloud in Greek class. Mm-hmm. But in Arabic, I was very much at that sort of hooked on phonics level where you're like, okay, and there are a few words that I have as sight words in Arabic. One of them is the word for and, which is wa. One of them is the word for the, which is al. And one of them is the word for book, because kitab just shows up all the time. But most of the words I had to kind of painstakingly sound out each letter and then listen to myself as I was saying them and be like, oh, it's that word, even if I knew it. which is this process that I must have gone through in English, but I don't remember doing it for the Latin script.
And I think that is one of the things that makes it really hard for people who grow up in highly literate, highly educated societies to tease writing and reading apart from language. But actually, when you step back, you realize that writing is actually super weird.
It's so weird. And it's this interesting sort of, it really is a technology. It's a, you know, a thing you do on top of language to do stuff with language, but it's not the language itself. And there are, you know, thousands, possibly millions of languages that have never been written down in the history of humanity. We have no idea. And, you know, we've never met a society of humans or heard of a society of humans without language, but those are spoken and signed languages, which are just kind of there. And writing, by contrast, was invented somewhere between 3 and 4 times in the history of humanity.
That we know of.
That we know of.
There might have been a society that did a very ephemeral form of snow writing that we have lost forever, but we have records of 3 or 4 times.
Yeah, it's been invented a handful of times, and there are a few other cases where there are scripts that haven't been deciphered by modern humans, and so maybe they're scripts and maybe they're not, and it's not quite clear, but it's definitely sort of a handful number of times, and then once other cultures come in contact with the technology of writing, they're like, oh, this is cool, let's sort of adapt this to our linguistic situation, and it gets borrowed a heck of a lot, but it only gets invented a few times.
It's worth saying that 3 to 4 is a bit squishy because it's not entirely yep. clear if cuneiform, which is a very kind of pointy form of writing from Babylonia, somehow inspired the Egyptian system that became what we know as the hieroglyphs, or if they just happened around the same time by coincidence, something we may never really fully put together. But that's a very contested situation. And that's why we can't even pin down the number of times we think it was invented.
Yeah, so the cuneiform is the one that's made with a sort of sharpened reed that you push into your, you know, clay tablets, or if you're some people on the internet, into your gingerbread, because there's some really excellent examples of cuneiform gingerbread that tablets people have baked, which I just want to, yeah, it's really great. And then the Egyptian hieroglyphs people have seen, but yeah, it's unclear whether they were in contact with each other and kind of heard of each other in a very loose sense and were inspired by each other because there was some amount of contact between those two areas, or if that was elsewhere. And then the other two, one is in Mesoamerica, in modern day Mexico and that area, where they had a writing system there that, again, developed into lots of different scripts as it got borrowed from different areas, of which the best deciphered is the Mayan script from the 3rd century BCE, but there's also the Olmec script, which is probably the oldest. Zapotec script is also really old. So there's a bunch of sort of scripts in the modern day Mexico area that also developed independently.
And then the final system arose in China around the Bronze Age, kind of a couple of thousand years BCE. And because this script was mostly found in its most earliest forms on oracle bones, that it's known as the oracle bone script.
What is an oracle bone?
They are turtle bones that are used in divination.
Oh.
Yeah.
And again, the Chinese script, once it developed further, was also, yeah, influenced a bunch of the other writing systems in the area.
I find it super fascinating, with absolutely no historical knowledge or insight to bring to this, that in these three different places that were completely separate and going about their own cultural lives, writing kind of arose at this similar time around like 3 to 4,000 years ago.
Yeah, you kind of wonder what was in the water or something.
Yeah.
Well, and it's partially, I think, that there's a certain level of, you know, writing makes it easier to do things like administrative bureaucracy if you're trying to keep track of, like, whether people paid their taxes or, you know.
Oh, yeah.
It's a very empire-y thing to have, is to develop a writing system.
Oh, yeah. And it's absolutely worth stating that it's not like three people in these three different locations all woke up on the same Tuesday 4,000 years ago and were like, I'm going to write a long letter to someone.
Did they have Tuesdays 4,000 years ago?
What you see is this emergence of, like, I'm just going to make a couple of notes so I know how much money you owe me. Like, some of the earliest cuneiform tablets we have are just like beer supply stock takes.
Yeah, like three oxes and this many baskets of grain or whatever.
I feel like it's very human to be like, we love writing because it's, you know, poetry and I can send letters to people I love. And it's like, no, it's actually, I just wanted to know how much you owe me.
The king just wants to know if these people have paid their taxes.
Yeah. And so what you get is like, you know, it although I'm like, oh, it all happened within like similar millennia, it is actually like centuries of development from like just keeping tabs on a few items to a fully fleshed out written system.
Yeah. And what types of things people thought were important to write down, you know, things like legal codes and stuff like that. One of the interesting things that I came across when I was looking this up was that there's a person named Enheduanna, who is the earliest known poet whose name has been recorded.
Nice.
And she was the high priestess of the goddess Inanna and the moon god Nanna in the Sumerian city-state of Ur. So,
awesome.
There we go. But, like, authorship shows up, you know, much later than, like, some anonymous, you know, civil servant keeping track of who's registered which grain, or some anonymous, like, priest or something keeping track of who's made various offerings. And this idea of, like, oh, you're going to write down poetry is a step later.
Filing your tax is what is actually one of the best links you have to those ancient civilizations.
Yeah. And there's, you know, there's this Egyptian named Tahotep. That's Ta-P-T, even though I'm not pronouncing it that. And he was a vizier in Egypt. And he's also one of the first named writers, the first book in history, or people call him the first book in history, because he wrote these Maxims of Tahotep. But, and yeah, there may have been people who were writing on more perishable materials that didn't get recorded and stuff like that, but it definitely, it's this whole process of, okay, I'm going to, you know, draw these little diagrams of oxen or something, or draw these little diagrams of, you know, this plant or this animal or whatever to record what types of things, you know, get recorded. But then, in order for it to actually become a writing system, there's also this step of abstraction that has to happen. And this is when you start saying, okay, well, the word for this sort of very easily visualizable thing. So I'm thinking of oxen because the word for ox in one of the Semitic languages, I think, was something like aleph. And so this ox's head gets transformed into, okay, what if this is the sound at the beginning of the word for ox's head, which is aleph, and gets transformed into our modern letter A, which is alpha. And alpha in Greek is just the name of the letter. It's not an ox's head in Greek anymore because the Greeks borrowed it from the Phoenicians. But this level of abstraction that has to go from, okay, I'm going to draw an ox's head. If you turn a capital A upside down, it kind of looks like an ox's head.
It's got its little horns, which are the feet of an A.
Yeah. And there are all these sort of related languages. You know, Arabic's got aleph at the beginning, even though it doesn't look like an ox's head anymore. And Hebrew's got an aleph, and, you know, Greek's got an alpha, and all of these sort of alphabets that begin with A. But it's this level of abstraction where you can use this thing to stand for this thing that was associated with an ox.
And there are a couple of main different ways that you can relate these abstract images that you're putting down in writing to the language that you are trying to capture. And of course, being a linguistics podcast, I was going to bring this straight back to the structure of language.
Well, I think it's interesting to look at sort of the structure of languages in different areas of the world and how people reflect those in the writing systems that are developed for those languages. And when they borrow a writing system for a language with a very different structure, end up doing certain adaptations to account for not just like, okay, languages have different sounds, but also those sounds are sort of organized and structured in different ways with relationship to each other. And the writing systems often reflect some of that history.
Yeah. The Latin alphabet that both of us are most familiar with has a very approximate correspondence between each character of the writing system and a sound in the language. And I say approximate because English spelling is a wonderful historical record of how some of those sound changes have changed over time. Just going to keep this upbeat, and you can fall down a giant well of English writing system problems. But to get to a point where the majority of letters have a pretty stable correspondence to sounds that we recognize as phones in the language, and that allows us to write out the words of English.
Yeah, and one of the things that's true about a lot of the Indo-European languages is that they have a particular sort of ratio between consonants and vowels in the words, where they have like kind of a fair bit of consonants in relationship to their vowels, but not a ton. And you can see this in the writing system because the writing system, you know, represents consonants and vowels separately. And yet when the Greeks were borrowing the alphabet from the Phoenicians, Phoenician is a Semitic language like modern day Arabic and Hebrew, and that alphabet only had consonants in it, letters for consonants, because the vowels were like not that important.
Mm-hmm.
And this is still true of modern day Semitic languages, is they're often written in writing systems that don't represent the vowels, or kind of optionally represent the short vowels, or sometimes they represent the long vowels, but they're often written in writing systems where the vowels can be omitted. And that's not really a thing that you can do very well in Indo-European languages and still have things understood, because the vowels carry sort of enough information that you need to represent them somehow.
Yeah, so even when you have a phonemic script, it's not necessary to always represent all of the sounds to convey the language.
Right. And then sort of conversely, there are other languages where the vowels are even more important. And in fact, like every consonant comes with a vowel, or virtually every consonant comes with a vowel. And in those, you often get what are called syllabaries, where they represent, you know, one syllable at a time, because, you know, why bother with representing each of these things separately when, you know, in every context where you have a consonant, there's going to be a nearby vowel, or virtually every context, there's going to be a nearby vowel. And so you can have a symbol that just represents the whole syllable there. And so that's also a structure that doesn't work very well for Indo-European languages, because they don't have that many vowels. So there's kind of this spot of like, they have important enough vowels that you need to represent the vowel somehow, but not so important vowels that you have to represent lots of vowels all the time. Whereas languages like Japanese or Hindi, well, Hindi's Indo-European, but it's got more vowels, I guess.
and it has a really nice, the Devanagari writing system is inherently focused on the kind of syllable, which is a very different approach to reading. And each character of this writing system, if there's no vowel specified, it just comes with a bonus vowel. It's like, buy this consonant, get this free letter A sound.
Right. And it's partly a feature of the writing system, but it can only be a feature of the writing system because it's already a feature of the language.
Mm-hmm.
A similar thing goes for a language like Chinese, where a lot of things are based around a syllable.
And then you can go a level of abstraction further, where your character in the writing system represents a kind of word level thing and doesn't have a direct relationship to the sound correspondence, which is what happens with the Chinese script.
Right. And I think it's important to recognize that there is a phonetic component to mm-hmm. Chinese characters. Like, they often make use of, especially for words that are more abstract, like, it's not just like, oh, here's a bunch of little pictures that we've drawn, because that's not capable of conveying, you know, abstract concepts like grammatical particles and, you know, words for things that don't come with easy pictures. And so making use of, okay, a lot of our words are one or two syllables long, and so, you know, here's a word that's relatively easy to visualize that sounds very similar to a word that is not as easy to visualize, and we could just add a thing to be like, it sounds like this, but it's got a meaning more related to this, and you can be like, oh, it must be this more abstract word. And the classic example, which I'm definitely going to do the tones wrong on, is that the word for horse is ma, and the word for mother is also ma with a different tone, and you can add, you know, the little horse semantic component with the woman semantic component and be like, oh, it's the word that sounds like horse but has to do something with a woman, and then you end up with mother.
And this works for languages in China because they tend to be not as long as words in English. We like to add all these extra bits of morphology within our grammar, whereas, again, you get not a direct like rule force, but you get this general tendency where the writing system kind of fits with the vibe of the grammar of the language.
Right. And one example of that is in Japanese, where they were heavily influenced by the Chinese script, but Japanese actually does have suffixes and other little grammatical words and, you know, things you need to change about words. And they made some of the Chinese characters that had formerly only had kind of semantic things into just like, oh, this makes this sound and this makes this sound, because they needed to be able to represent that morphological information that's not super important in Chinese, but is very important in Japanese. So you end up kind of adapting a script into something else when it gets borrowed in a different context. Another interesting example here is Farsi or Persian, mm-hmm. which is an Indo-European language that's conventionally written with the same script as Arabic, except it's also had a couple additional letters added because, like, Persian has a P and Arabic doesn't. Yeah. So they had to create a symbol for the sound P, which is why you get Farsi instead of Parsi, because Arabic doesn't pronounce that P.
Huh.
And so it makes the P into an F. So sometimes you get people adding additional letters, like adding a letter for P. Sometimes you get, you know, adapting whole sets of a script.
Sometimes you lose letters. English had distinct characters for th and the until it was technologically easier to just use the characters in the printing press that English had borrowed. And makes me a little bit sad. But also it makes international keyboards a little bit easier. So
yeah, we used to have a thorn for the sound, but those like early printing presses from continental Europe didn't have thorns on them. So I mean, Icelandic still has thorns.
Yeah.
One of the things that I think is more interesting in the, you know, closer to modern era, not strictly modern era, is cultures and peoples that are familiar with the idea of writing, yet take the idea of writing and say, we're going to make our own homegrown script that actually works really well for our particular language. One of my favorites is the Cherokee syllabary, which was invented by Sequoia, who is a Cherokee man who didn't know how to read in English, but he'd encountered the, you know, Latin-based writing system in English, and he thought it was cool that the English speakers had this. And so he like locked himself in a shed for several years and came up with a syllabary for Cherokee. And some of the symbols on the Cherokee syllabary look something like Latin letters, but they stand for completely different things because he wasn't just like learning to read from English, and some of them are completely different. And this became like hugely popular among the Cherokee in the area. There were newspapers in this in like the 1800s. There was very high literacy in Cherokee country, and it was really popular. And it's even still found on modern day computer keyboards and stuff like this. You can, you know, get Windows and stuff in Cherokee. And it's this interesting example of like, that's one where we can say a particular person was inspired by writing systems, but also created his own thing that became very popular.
The thing that makes Cherokee so compelling to me is not only did he come up with an incredibly elegant, well thought out, suits the language system, but that he actually got uptake as well, that the community decided to use this as the writing system that they would learn to read and write in, and that it had uptake. It's very easy to come up with ways of improving the technology of writing, but as I think you're fond of saying, language is very much an open source project, and you can come up with really elegant solutions, but if no one else is going to take them up, that's not going to be very helpful. So Sequoia's work is doubly amazing for that reason.
Yeah, you know, people actually made like printing presses with the Cherokee symbols and were using those. Another interesting case of this sort of disconnect between like a person or people coming up with a system and actual uptake of it is Korean, which has what I think linguists generally agree is just like the best writing system.
Yeah, we're like, writing as a technology is amazing. All writing systems are equally valid, but Korean is particularly great.
But Korean's really cool. And the thing that's cool about it from a completely biased linguist perspective is that the writing system of Korean Hangul, the script, is not just based on individual sounds or phonemes. It's actually at a more precise level based on the shape of the mouth and how you configure the mouth in order to make those particular sounds. And so there's a lot of, okay, here are these sort of closely related sounds. Let's say you make them all with the lips and you just add an additional stroke to make it this other related sound that you make with the lips. And so between like P and B and M, which are all made with the lips, those symbols have a similar shape and it's not an accident. And it's very systematic between that and the same thing with like T and D and N. Those have a similar shape because they have this sort of relationship. So it's very technically beautiful from an analysis of language perspective.
I love this so much that when we were prototyping a potential script for the Aram Tescan language for the Shadow Sent books, when I was constructing that language, I also started constructing a script that we never used anywhere, but it was helpful to think about how the characters would write and what writing implements they would use. And if you look at the script, you'll notice that the letter P and B are very similar, but B has an additional stroke. T and D are very similar, but D has an additional stroke. And so very much feature-driven. And then for the vowels, it's roughly a quadrant in the writing space. The E vowel is in the top left of the quadrant. The U vowel is in the top right of the quadrant. The R vowel is in the bottom left of the quadrant.
So clever.
It was actually just for really selfish reasons that I decided to go with a feature-based system, and that is that it was easier for me to remember. If I used the features of the language and made sure that the voiced sound was always identical to the voiceless one, but just with an additional stroke, it meant that I only had to remember half the characters.
That's very elegant. The easy-to-remember bit is also true about the Hangul script because it's got so much regularity. The sort of famous quote about Hangul is something like, a wise man can learn it in an afternoon and a foolish man can learn it in a day.
So catchy.
There's probably a better version of that quote. But what's interesting about it from an adoption perspective is that Hangul was invented by King Sejong the Great.
Appropriately named.
Yeah, who has like a national holiday now because of the script. But it was created in 1443. And it's not quite clear whether it was like him personally doing everything or whether he had sort of a advisory committee of linguists. But it's really extremely well adapted to linguistic situation of Korean in particular, even though it's just like also really cool for how it represents the inside of the mouth, but it's really well adapted for Korean. And it was invented in 1443, but it wasn't popularized in use until several centuries later, because for a long time, Korean was also using kind of like Japanese, this sort of adapted version of the Chinese script or adapted version of the Japanese script because of the sort of cultural influences. And then in the early 20th century, they were doing a much bigger literacy push in Korea to be like, we want everyone to know how to read. And they said, okay, we're going to have an orthographic reform and we're going to use this script, which has this, you know, sort of very nice historical pedigree, but also is much easier to learn than this, you know, complicated thing that we had done that wasn't originally designed for Korean. So it's got this sort of historical antecedents, but also in kind of came back in the modern day. And now like everything in Korean is written in it. And it's because it's really easy to learn how to read and write in. So the historical uptake wasn't immediate. It wasn't like during King Sejong's lifetime where they were like, oh yeah, now we're all going to use his script. People were like, okay, King, you've got this hobby. But it wasn't popularized until later.
Even when there is really strong abstraction, humans have this unavoidable tendency to think about the relationship between sounds and other senses. And so in sound-based writing systems, Susie Stiles, who has been on the podcast before and works on perception across the senses, did an experiment alongside Nora Turuman where they looked at whether people can guess for writing systems they're not familiar with.
Ooh.
Which character was the ooh sound and which character was the E sound.
Huh.
And they found that for a whole variety of scripts, there is a much higher than chance, because, you know, there's only two choices. If it was completely arbitrary, it would be 50-50.
Yeah.
But people do tend, across the evolution of sound-based writing systems, to have ooh that has more kind of rounded, biggest sound, has properties in the writing system that reoccur, and people continue to unavoidably link the sounds of the language to the written properties of the script in a very low level way. Yeah, I'll link to that study. It's really great.
Oh, that's interesting. It's not going to be 100%, but there's a slightly better than chance relationship.
Yeah.
Visual representation of physical information is also something that shows up in ways of writing sign languages.
Yeah, everything we've talked about so far, I think we've talked about for spoken languages, but it is possible to write signed languages as well.
Yeah, and there are several different systems in place, and some of them are kind of language specific, like, oh, this is a system for writing ASL in particular, and some of them are kind of like your linguist international phonetic alphabet trying to provide a language agnostic way of writing sign languages for sort of research purposes, but in a way that's sort of impractical, like the IPA, for general use. There's kind of an interesting set of systems, and there isn't as much agreement among representers of signed languages in writing which amounts of information are sort of crucial information that has to be written down and which are sort of optional bits of information that the reader can fill in from their own knowledge of the language and the signer.
I think it's worth flagging that that's not just a discussion that arises for signed languages. It's just that those conversations got thrashed out for spoken languages 4 millennia ago, and we weren't around when people were arguing about whether intonation had any role in the, or people probably weren't arguing it just because it was an emerging thing.
Well, when people were arguing about, like, do we write vowels or not?
Yeah.
Which was a big thing. You know, do we write vowels? Do we write intonation? And, like, punctuation followed quite a bit after, you know, like, punctuation wasn't as much of a thing for several of the early centuries and millennia of writing. They didn't do punctuation. There's some level of ongoingness that's still there. You know, if you think about the internet efforts to try to write tone of voice very precisely and communicate sarcasm and irony and, you know, rhetorical questions very precisely, there's some level of kind of ongoing debate that's still happening in the spoken language context, but not nearly as much as is still happening in the sign language context.
Also, just because of the way that signed language communities tend to be embedded within larger spoken language communities, people who sign as a primary language tend to also be educated in the mainstream spoken language. And so literacy gets developed in, say, a language like English.
I think that's the case for a lot of smaller spoken languages as well, where sometimes there's this imperative, okay, we want to be able to write things to each other or something, but if there hasn't been a history of a lot of published literature in that language that you're trying to read, then it becomes a sort of question of, well, should we teach this in school because there isn't literature there, even though there would be oral literature? But it becomes a sort of chicken and egg problem of which comes first or which do you start teaching first when you're constantly comparing stuff against sort of a few very large spoken languages that have this very long writing tradition. It shows up in languages with a newer writing tradition.
Yeah, education systems have a massive influence there. My grandmother, actually, her strongest written language is German. Even though her and her sister speak to each other in Polish, they would write to each other in German because that's the language they had been educated to write in. So even with people who don't speak minority languages, just the influence of the education system there is so massive.
Yeah, and like reading and writing, they're separate skills, even though they're often taught together. And sometimes you can read a language that you can't write or something like that. But it's a sort of big question. And with signed languages, because they, because video technology is now available, you know, if we'd had good audio recording technology 4,000 years ago, the pressure to develop writing systems for spoken languages might not have been as strong. Probably wouldn't have been as strong. Even though there are other useful things that writing can do, even in the audio video era, it's easier to be like, well, you could just make a video of the signer, and then you'd know exactly what they were trying to say and exactly how they wanted to say it, and you wouldn't have this sort of level of abstraction of, are you going to try to write it down in a way that kind of imperfectly represents what a person is going to do when they're producing it. It is still interesting looking at some of the sign language writing systems. Some of them, like Stokoe notation and Hamnosis, which stands for Hamburg Notation System, they try to very physically represent the characteristics of the signer, you know, where their hands are, where their face is, and things like that. There's another one that I can't find the name of that is based on the ASCII alphabet, so you can, you know, type it into search engine boxes, which has some advantages as well, but represents things more abstractly. And so it's got this link with Korean, which is representing this very physical aspect of what the mouth is doing. And several of the sign language writing systems like Stokoe and Hamnosis also have this very physical representation, what the body is doing when it's being produced. But I think they're more popular among researchers than they are among actual deaf users who tend to use video a lot.
Oh yeah, I encounter Stokoe and Hamnosis in the gesture and sign linguistics literature, and I haven't really seen them too much outside of that.
And I think that it's easy to sort of conflate a language with its writing system because we're so used to thinking of English as sort of inextricably linked to the Latin alphabet. But there isn't a reason in theory why you couldn't write English in the Greek alphabet or in the Arabic alphabet or in a, you know, very adapted version of Chinese characters where you'd have to do a lot of adaptation. But the same thing is true when you write languages that don't originally use the Latin alphabet and you have romanizations of them. So writing systems are just as much political and contextual. Some of them have this sort of very tight structural relationship to the properties of the languages they represent, and some of them have looser relationships because they've been adapted to it later.
It's this slightly looser relationship to language as it's spoken or signed that means that linguists don't always include writing systems in, say, an introduction to linguistics course, and we don't often talk about writing systems. But when we were putting together the Crash Course series, we ended up making writing the topic of our final episode for the series.
Yeah, and I think partly because people are really interested in it, so why not do something about writing? And also because I think that you can use writing systems as a window into some of the interesting structural features of different languages and how the writing systems represent that. And, you know, as somebody who's really interested in internet linguistics and the rise of informal writing and how we represent, you know, tone of voice and things like that in modern day writing, and that's still sort of a moving target, evolutionarily speaking, I think it's interesting to give that sort of linguistic lens on writing systems, even though they are imperfect representations of the languages that they represent.
Writing systems is video 16 of Crash Course Linguistics, which is wrapping up this month. So if you've been holding out to watch all 16 of those episodes, you'll be able to do so very soon, or perhaps even now, thanks to the temporal vagueness of podcasts.
Crash Course is a YouTube series that we've been working on for, you know, basically all of 2020. And it's especially popular with high school or undergraduate teaching. So if you know people that age or who teach people that age, that may be a useful thing to send to people. We hope that people find it useful as a resource for self-teaching or for instructing in various capacities.
For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts, and you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, not judging your grammar, just analysing it mugs, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I tweet and blog as Superlinguo.
I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 48 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans, like, do you remember learning how to read? And other rewards, as well as helping keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include an AMA with a lexicographer and our favorite stories and anecdotes that we just didn't have time for in some of the earlier episodes. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We also really appreciate if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their life. And hey, tell your other favorite podcasts that they could do a linguistics episode and get us on. It'd be fun.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne. Our editorial producer is Sarah Doppiarella. And our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic!